Happy Halloween, everybody. It is such a joy to be gathered in virtual space with all of you. This is a special season for a special few days. We know it's Halloween, a time for pretending to be someone else. It's also Samhain, well, that begins tonight, which is the third harvest festival of the pagan wheel of the year. And in many cultures, this is a time when the boundaries between the living and the dead grow thinner, with All Saints and All Souls and Dia de los Muertos. It's a time to remember our beloved dead and the exemplars who have died. So however you mark this time, whether it is with candles and solitude, with memory, with tremendous amounts of candy, with costumes, I wish you a happy season, a meaningful season. So come, let us gather. Come, let us worship together.
Good morning. My name is Sibel Shattuck. I am a member of the Sunday Services Committee, and it is my privilege to welcome you to People's Church this morning. As Reverend Rachel commented, today is, of course, Halloween, All Hallows Eve.
A transitional festival marking the end of summer's brightness and the harvest season's bounty. We're moving into the time of short days and long nights when plants go dormant and animals hibernate. And of course, American society loves to turn these old holy days into commercial celebrations, but we don't seem to lose them entirely. And perhaps that is because even in our modern industrialized lives, we still respond to the turning of the seasons, the changes in light and temperature. Maybe the candy is just our way of bulking up for winter. People's Church belongs to the Unitarian Universalist tradition, a tradition that finds wisdom in the old spiritual traditions and also in new innovations. Together, we strive to be a beloved community embracing and serving our diverse world. And when I heard that Reverend Rachel would be dressed as a shark today, it reminded me that I spent a large part of my childhood attending a school called Harmony. Now, it was not named Harmony for groovy hippie reasons, even though we did have a fair number of those amongst the parents of our community, but rather because this school had been built to replace all of the single one and two room schoolhouses in the separate canyons nearby and to bring everybody together in one centralized school where we could learn together. So that school wasn't just about education, it was also about community and community ties. And the best thing about that school was that the playground had this giant play structure built out of redwood. And we used to play a game called Land Shark, Water Shark, which basically was tag with two people who were it, one on top of the structure on the land and one down in the tan bark in the water. And it is possible that I sustained a few mild concussions ducking under that structure when my head encountered beams trying to escape the water shark, which could explain some things, I don't know. But what I thought about today was how we were two communities, one on land, one in water, both moving together, swirling, becoming it, becoming not it, even though we were in two different media of land and water, one community, just as today, we are in two different media, in person and online. So we are very glad you are here, whether in person or online, to be part of our community on this Halloween day. Welcome.
Thank you, Sibel. I have one brief announcement as we begin. People's Church is still looking to hire a part-time weekend custodian. So if you know of anyone who has done this sort of work before and is looking for a part-time job, please encourage them to be in touch with me. It is a challenging time to make hires, and we know that within our networks we have contacts, and so please use them to help us find the right person for this role. And now I invite you to sing. Our chalice lighting today comes from Cynthia Landrum. Mindful that with great power comes great responsibility, we light this chalice in the hopes that in brightest day, in blackest night, our faith will flame on. If you are lighting a chalice at home, please share where you're lighting that chalice in the chat on Zoom. I have a Halloween story for us all today. It's one of my favorite stories about Halloween, and it is a true story that happened a number of years ago. It's a story about a little boy named Dyson. And Dyson was a boy who loved everything sparkly and twirly and beautiful. And sometimes his parents worried that people would be mean to him because of that. But at preschool, it was fine. They had really good dress-ups, and all of his teachers and classmates just understood that that was who Dyson was and that is what he loved. But then he went to kindergarten, and his mom especially was worried. So a few months into kindergarten, Dyson and his mom and his big brother, Jacoby, went to the store to find Halloween costumes. And so big brother found a Ninja Turtle costume, a bit like this one, and was so excited. And so that's what he got. And then Dyson found this blue princess dress, a bit like this one, that he wanted to wear for Halloween. And he was so excited. And his mom was a little bit worried. Everyone at preschool knew that princess dresses were for boys and for girls, but would everyone in kindergarten know that? Would the big kids make fun of him, or what would his teacher say? And so the big brother, Jacoby, could see on his mom's face that she was feeling worried. And so he said, "Mom, you gotta let him get the thing that makes him happy." And the mom knew that. And so she bought Dyson the beautiful princess dress. But she was still worried about this. She'd heard stories of kids getting teased for being different when boys liked things that most people thought were only for girls. And so she called the teacher and explained the situation. And the teacher read a story to the whole class about how everything is for everybody. There is no such thing as something only for boys or only for girls or only for non-binary children. And so she was feeling better. And the teacher also talked to the other grown-ups at the school. And those grown-ups really wanted Dyson to feel safe and loved on Halloween. And so on Halloween day, when Dyson came to school, he saw that most of the grown men in the school were dressed as ballerinas. They were wearing tutus, a little bit like this one, but much larger. And they had worked together to learn a special ballerina dance that they did for all of the kids at lunchtime to help them know that anyone can be anything they want for Halloween. There's nothing that's only for one kind of kid. And that's a story that makes me feel really happy to think of those grown-ups being brave and maybe doing something that felt a little bit uncomfortable for them, like being a ballerina for a day, to make a kindergartner feel a little more safe at school. So that's our story, and that's part of the power of Halloween, to be something different for a day. It is strange to tell a story on these steps by myself. I am feeling some feelings. And as I introduce the offering, I want to talk about what a gift it is to raise children in this church. So our children are right now are outside, if they're under 12, or in classrooms right now, learning and growing and getting reconnected with each other in powerful ways. And I have a couple of stories about how it has been such a gift for my family to raise my kids in this church, because people's people are generous people. So my eldest child over the last month or so has become fascinated by Kazakhstan, the country in Central Asia, for reasons we don't entirely understand, but they have a good flag. And I think he saw it at the while we were watching Olympics or something. I don't know. Kid interests boggle the mind. And so we wanted to support him in that. And we've looked for children's books about Kazakhstan, and there's really nothing. And so a few weeks ago, I put out a call on Facebook. Does anybody know anyone from Kazakhstan? Has anyone been to Kazakhstan? Would you be willing to Zoom with my six-year-old and answer some of his questions? And a people's person, a people's family, has a nephew who is married to a woman from Kazakhstan. And so they reached out. And last Monday evening, we had a Zoom meeting with this wonderful woman named Aliyah, who answered all of the questions we had. And we had a long list about food and clothes and sports and what school is like there. And it was just wonderful. And it was something that we wouldn't have had that connection where it weren't for this church, where it weren't for a person who saw that Facebook wondering and acted on it. And that has been really, really lovely this week to have more to learn about Kazakhstan. And the second story is that my children, I don't think a day goes by when they do not wear something that was previously worn by another child of this church. We get so many wonderful, glorious hand-me-downs from the kids who are just a year or two older, and often then we pass them on to the kids who are a little bit younger. So there's this secret underground flow of clothing that is almost always their very favorite things. And a couple of weeks ago, we got a call from our partners at Lincoln School who needed some more extra clothes for the times that kids spill on themselves or get messy doing art or otherwise just need different clothes to change into during the school day. And I could look at my boxes of clothes in the basement and the new shipment that had just arrived from a church family, and outfit almost all of the clothes that were needed and almost all of the sizes, just with the extras that we had. And so it was such a glorious thing to be able to take these clothes that were given to our family by various other families in the church and then send them on to clothe some of the children at Lincoln School. And where we were short, we put out a call in the church parents' Facebook page, and a number of folks either brought in their extras or went out shopping to make sure that all of the kids at Lincoln School had dry and clean things to change into should the need arise. So thank you for all of the big and small ways you are generous, people's people. I invite you to continue to be generous in your financial support of the church. The offering will now be received.
Please join me in expressing gratitude for the generosity of our community. From the countless gifts we each have been given, gifts of life, love, and sustenance, we bring these small portions to share in the works of love which none of us can accomplish alone. People's people
support one another in good times and hard times and in between times. One of the ways we do that is by when we gather, taking time to mark the joys and sorrows and milestones in our lives. So if you have something that you wish to share with our gathered community today, I invite you to type it into our chat box if you are joining us on Zoom, or if you are one of the few people in this space, we have note cards and a basket to minimize the amount of close contact. So I invite you to share a joy or sorrow, or if you want to just be held in this community without saying what it is that is going on, that is fine too. You can just simply type stone and Sabelle will place a stone for you. These joys and sorrows will be with us after the service is over. For this moment, set them aside and just take a moment to breathe deeply, letting your shoulders rise up and back and down as you breathe out. And let's do that two more times. Breathing in and letting your shoulders extend backwards and down, opening your chest so there's more room for air. And a third time. And just focus on your breath, let your mind rest, and we'll sit in silence for a few moments.
Our first reading is by Adrian Rich, entitled Diving into the Wreck. First, having read the Book of Myths and loaded the camera and checked the edge of the knife blade, I put on the body armor of black rubber, the absurd flippers, the grave and awkward mask. I am having to do this not like Cousteau with his assiduous team aboard the sun-floated schooner, but here alone. There is a ladder. The ladder is always there, hanging innocently close to the side of the schooner. We know what it is for, we who have used it. Otherwise, it is a piece of maritime floss, some sundry equipment. I go down, rung after rung, and still the oxygen immerses me, the blue light, the clear atoms of our human air. I go down. My flippers cripple me. I crawl like an insect down the ladder, and there is no one to tell me when the ocean will begin. First, the air is blue, and then it is bluer, and then green, and then black. I am blacking out, and yet my mask is powerful. It pumps my blood with power. The sea is another story. The sea is not a question of power. I have to learn alone to turn my body without force in the deep element. And now, it is easy to forget what I came for among so many who have always lived here, swaying their crenellated fans between the reefs. And besides, you breathe differently down here. I came to explore the wreck. The words are purpose. The words are maps. I came to see the damage that was done and the treasures that prevail. I stroke the beam of my lamp slowly along the flank of something more permanent than fish or weed, the thing I came for, the wreck and not the story of the wreck, the thing itself and not the myth. The drowned man always staring toward the sun, the evidence of damage worn by salt and sway into this threadbare beauty, the ribs of the disaster curving their assertion among the tentative haunters. This is the place, and I am here, the mermaid whose dark hair streams black, the merman in his armored body. We circle silently about the wreck. We dive into the hold. I am she, I am he whose drowned face sleeps with open eyes, whose breasts still bear the stress, whose silver, copper, vermeil cargo lies obscurely inside barrels half wedged and left to rot. We are the half destroyed instruments that once held to a course, the water eaten log, the fouled compass. We are, I am, you are, by cowardice or courage, the ones who find our way back to this scene, carrying a knife, a camera, a book of myths in which our names do not appear.
Our next reading is a part of In Praise of Praise by Sean Parker Dennison. Yes, even now when so much is at risk, praise the blood that pulses its systole and diastole rhythm, dancing to and from the heart. Even when the sky is smoke and our masks have become an ordinary necessity. Yes, even now when so much is a struggle, praise bodies that sweat and tremble, muscles tense with embodied comprehension that we are headed the wrong way, and the irresistible urge to change direction, a glorious, clumsy, prodigal return. Yes, especially now when so much is at stake, praise something, anything, so alive and extravagant that it awakens and calls you to discard despair, abandon apathy, and praise whatever brings you back to life. Halloween, especially this Halloween, is a good time to talk about masks. Most of us have been wearing masks of one kind or another for the last year and a half. Our cloth masks, or paper surgical masks, or N95s, or KN95s, they've become part of our lives. Perhaps you, like me, have a special place in your home where you store your mask collection. Perhaps you, like me, have developed a niche, an expertise in what style of mask offer the best combination of coverage and comfort for your particular face shape or those of the people that you love. Perhaps you, like me, have discovered some long-lost masks tucked in the pockets of the coat that you got out as the weather got colder. We all have developed a new relationship with masks in this pandemic season. And while there is much to say about the science of masks and the public policy related to them, I am setting that aside for today. I hope you are getting your information about science and public policy from sources that are not me. But I, as your minister, like to engage in masks as metaphor and idea and symbol and tool. How do masks hold us back or liberate us? How can masks and the lessons that we have learned while wearing them so often allow us to live with more integrity, to be truer versions of ourselves? Because masks do free us, at least many of us, to move about the world in different ways, The masks of Halloween allow us to be someone else, if only for a day. And the masks that we wear in this pandemic season keep us healthier as we work or venture out or seek to connect with others. Our poems today speak of masks that allow us to dive metaphorically beneath water and explore unknown worlds beneath the surface. And masks keep people breathing safe during the wildfires that have become seasonal in the western part of our country. Masks give us greater physical safety, and they protect us in other ways. Covering our nose and our mouth in public free us from the gaze and the demands of others. Many women, especially while out in public, are routinely interrupted by strangers and told to smile. This has happened to me a number of times, though it has waned as I tote small children and my hair goes gray. But it started happening in my teens and was pretty frequent. Some person that I didn't know, almost always male, almost always older than me, felt entitled to interrupt whatever thoughts were going through my head to tell me that I should be presenting myself differently. And I imagine that this person was trying to be friendly and brighten my day, but it never felt like that. It always felt like a reminder that they thought the most important thing about me was if I was pleasant to look at in that particular moment. It was a death by a thousand paper cuts, as so many microaggressions are. And many people have shared that wearing a mask has reduced strangers' demands that they smile. And while we can usually tell if someone is smiling just from looking at the top half of their face, there's still enough mystery, I guess, to keep strangers quiet. People whose natural resting face is perceived as grumpy share that they can move about in the world with greater ease and less demands from strangers that they have that their face look different. Of course, this problem isn't magically solved by mask mandates. I don't think much is, except the spread of the coronavirus. People will still continue to feel entitled to demand that other people's faces look a different way, at least for a while. And my spouse has told me stories about this. He works in a brew pub, and most of the servers who work there are young women, and their financial well-being is dependent on customers' tips. At the time when all restaurant employees were required by state law to be masked, it was not uncommon for the diners in the restaurant to demand that these young women servers remove their masks. They would say variations of, "If I can't tell if you're smiling at me, how will I know how much to tip you?" Telling these servers that the most important thing about them is how pleasant they are to look at, not how competent they are at their jobs. And I have a lot to say about wage structures in restaurants and how that makes people, especially young people, vulnerable to all sorts of harassment. But that's not what we're here for today. We know that masks don't fix structural problems, but they have given some people a brief break from having to actively manage how others perceive them. A brief glimpse of a kinder world. What would it look like if we just let people's faces rest as they rest? In a recent interview, actress Sandra Oh shared a complicated story about the gifts and challenges that this season of masking has brought to her. Oh is a Korean-Canadian actress who has starred in the movie Sideways and the TV shows Grey's Anatomy, Killing Eve, and The Chair, among many other things. And in this interview, she began by saying that masks are liberating. She says, "When you are a known person, wearing a mask is kind of great. because people will give you a little bit more time before they can figure out who you are. So I relished having pockets of my anonymity back behind a mask. She and others who are known have been able to move about the world with greater freedom and less interruption because of masks. I know I've had many moments out in the world at the grocery stores or otherwise where I think I recognize somebody, but I really can't be sure without seeing the bottom half of their face. And for me, it just feels super awkward, but I guess for the celebrities, it feels liberating that these people are not coming up to accost them in the grocery store line. And moments after expressing the relief at being more anonymous, O said a different thing. She said, having said that, what it has raised is, oh, I'm clearly an Asian lady wearing a mask. And sometimes wearing a mask where other people are not wearing a mask, and you can just tell. I mean, you just get more aware. You're ready for things. I know that I'm tremendously protected by my good fortune and privilege, but I'm also still an Asian woman. For O, the increased anonymity that comes with wearing a mask, not being seen as the famous person that she is, means less safety. She feels less secure moving through the world when it isn't instantly obvious to people who watch TV and movies that she's an award-winning actress. It's harder when those around her just see her as an Asian woman. And there are many ways a person could react to this experience, ignoring it or shoring up privilege to try to keep herself as safe as possible among others. And O has chosen the path of compassion and activism, speaking at rallies following violence against Asian women in Atlanta last spring, telling the story in her media appearances, promoting her most recent projects. Putting on a mask has helped connect Sandra Oh to the everyday struggles facing others who share her identities. Wearing masks and costumes can open us up to more compassion for others. It can be a tool to help us create a glimpse of the beloved community, the reign of love and justice that we yearn for, that is and probably will always be perpetually out of reach. We saw it in the story of Dyson, the boy who wanted to be a princess, and the men at his school who became ballerinas to help him feel safe. There's something about changing your appearance in that way that communicates more than any anti-bullying policy or promise from a teacher could. They use joy and performance to change their little corner of the world. And I have another story like that to offer you today. So this is the story of Super Barrio, a lucha libre wrestler in Mexico City. Reed, there's a picture that I want you to share. Is it on for the people on Zoom? Okay, great. Those of you in person, just imagine a super lucha libre wrestler with a red and a yellow mask. So lucha libre is a form of wrestling popular in Mexico. It's very theatrical, and the wrestlers wear masks, and most of them keep their true identity secret from the world. There's often elaborate storylines of good versus evil. And Super Barrio is a real life wrestler, someone who took that identity out of the ring to make a difference. So I learned about him from the book, A Paradise Built in Hell, The Extraordinary Communities That Arise in Disaster by Rebecca Solnit. It's a powerful book about how surviving catastrophe often brings out our most generous impulses. I think it was a book that about half a dozen people have recommended to me over the past year. It's a gem. And in a section on the aftermath of an earthquake that destroyed much of Mexico City in 1985, she writes about Super Barrio. She writes, one wrestler came from far outside the ring to wrestle with injustice. Super Barrio emerged from the ruins of the 1985 earthquake, or rather from the struggle that came out of the earthquake. When politicians cut ribbons or stage other public events that they hoped would reflect well on them, Super Barrio would show up and pressure them to do better by the poor. He confronted landlords, showed up at evictions, meetings, and demonstrations, inspired the strugglers to feel more powerful and confident. He became famous as a sort of latter-day Robin Hood of the urban poor, and he lives on decades after he first appeared. He is credited with stopping 10,000 evictions. So he is a real-life superhero of sorts, using the power of his image and the anonymity that the mask and costume provides to confront those he has identified as acting in villainous ways. He began shortly after the earthquake. The earthquake destroyed much of the housing stock of Mexico City. And the landlords whose buildings were not damaged realized that they could evict the current residents and increase the rent and make a lot more money. And a group of activists held protests to try to stop these evictions. This was right after the death of an iconic lucha libre wrestler. And so that image was fresh in people's minds. And people imagined that they could create their own masked wrestler superhero to defend the rights of renters. They created Super Barrio, which is a play on Nintendo's Super Mario and Mario character. And then Barrio is a Spanish word for a poorer neighborhood. So creating this character was a team effort. They decided on a red and yellow color scheme, and this team of activists kind of each spread out and took responsibility for different parts of the costume. Someone ran off to the shoot, ran off to get shoes, and someone went to get tights, and then another person mask and the logo. There's now the people in the room can see. The next day he showed up at a protest, and he later joined a neighborhood group for a meeting with municipal authorities about housing. Activists report that the government leaders were shocked to see a masked figure at their meeting, understandably, and that it was a really useful strategy because nobody wants to be in opposition to a superhero. It makes you feel really bad. So the neighborhood activists had a much better negotiating session than they had anticipated, and they gave the credit to Super Barrio. In her book, Solnit describes meeting the one man who is publicly identified with Super Barrio. He's an ex-revolutionary, former prisoner, La Jornada columnist, tenant organizer, and restaurateur Marco Rascón. She writes, he is kind, burly, grizzled, and hospitable, even to would-be interviewers with lousy Spanish who show up at closing time. When he spoke of the origins of Super Barrio, he recalls that the creation of Super Barrio marked a turning point for these self-serious activists. At the time, we were very square militants, he said. We had very rigid ideas. People were very angry or very sad, and those were the forms of social struggle. I tried to support humor, but there was no support in that. Rascón reflected on the power of the hero he helped create. Super Barrio is a personality whose credibility exists while he has a mask on. Without the mask, he doesn't exist. There's a similar element to earlier national heroes such as El Santo or Zorro, as well as the echo of the pre-Hispanic origin of masks, the warriors in pre-Columbian times who donned animal masks to adopt their qualities. One of the things that has helped maintain Super Barrio's credibility is that the government has had to deal with him as a confrontational force. In addition, he has never allowed himself to be separated from his popular origins. When he speaks in public, he speaks in such a way that the average person can understand him. What he's expressing is the feelings of the people, especially those who got lost in the political discourse. That's why he's been able to achieve remarkable things. And he has. In addition to preventing 10,000 evictions, they say, he has run for president and otherwise just been kind of a thorn in the side of the establishment in Mexico City. reminding them that they need to care for the most vulnerable, and that helping them imagine themselves as something other than supervillains and trying to compromise and care. So I invite us all to imagine what it might look like to channel at least a little bit of Super Barrio. I'm not asking you to don the whole getup, but maybe the next time you put on a mask, whether that's part of Halloween festivities or part of your daily routine, you can channel something. What does it mean to be a little braver, to speak the truth to someone who needs to hear it from you? Superheroes Wear Masks is a story. It's a children's book put out by the people who make Sesame Street to try to explain this moment to young children about why you need to be separate, have space between yourself and your friends, and why you need to wear a mask. And I've read it to my children a number of times. And there's something really powerful about when we put our masks on to be like, okay, we're being heroes. We are keeping each other safe in this moment. And so it's true for adults too. I invite you, if you want, to offer yourself that affirmation that when you put your masks on, you are being a superhero. You are keeping other people safe. It takes a small act of heroism to keep doing this, because we know that these masks that we're wearing are not the most comfortable thing we could do, but it is worth that bit of discomfort to keep each other safe. So how might that moment of being a superhero help us to live more authentically, more compassionately, more bravely? Not all of us can or should create a lucha libre persona to keep people housed. But many of us can take the lessons of this moment to live more authentically. I have a story about that too. Returning to the issue of when people tell you your face needs to look different when you're out and about. So Trish Wend is a 62-year-old painter from Ridgefield, Connecticut. And she says that having strangers comment on her face, which just naturally looks stern, has been part of her life for decades. She was profiled in the Washington Post in an article about many people who have learned things from wearing a mask so much. And they write, for Wendt, the pandemic marked the first time in decades she hadn't felt any pressure to adopt an obsequious, apologetic smile when asking for help at the grocery store or the hardware store or the car dealership. For women, the smile sort of neutralizes you and implies that you're more pliable. You're not going to give them trouble, she says. With the smile suddenly out of the equation, Wendt says, it made me go a step further. I decided to not be the type of person who asks for something. Instead, I would tell them what I wanted. I would say, I need this. She plans to keep doing so even when she isn't wearing masks anymore. It's not the same as stopping thousands of evictions, but it is taking on the task of living a more authentic life, of being clearer in your communication, of not putting pleasing others above getting the needs that you have met. So we lit our chalice this morning with words adopted from three superheroes, Spider-Man, Green Lantern, and the Human Torch, all of whom are able to do the work of justice, in part because their true identity is unknown to most people. Almost every superhero has a secret identity. The words Sibel read were mindful. With great power comes great responsibility. We light this chalice in the hopes that in brightest day, in blackest night, our faith will flame on. So may each of us, in this season of masks, both fanciful and practical, be heroic in large ways and small ways, to be a superhero who wears a mask, to do the work of living authentically, choosing compassion, and building the beloved community. May it be so, may we make it so, and amen. So, dear ones, on this Halloween, may you channel the wild ones, whether it is a shark or a ghoul, and be a little bit braver than you might otherwise be. Go out and be a superhero wearing a mask, doing the work of love and justice. Let us go in peace and go in love.
Trey, look up at the sky. It's a full moon on the Sabbath.
This is scary.
Break it down.
I was working late on my haftorah when I heard a knock on my bedroom door. I opened it up, and to my surprise, there was a werewolf standing there with glowing gold eyes. He says, "Tomorrow, my son, you will be a man. But tonight's the time to join the wolfen clan. Tomorrow you will stand at the beamer and pray. But tonight, let's gaze at the moon and bathe. Werewolf for mitzvah, spooky, scary. Boys becoming men, men becoming wolf. Werewolf for mitzvah, spooky, scary. Boys becoming men, men becoming wolves."
All right, that was great, Trey. Okay, it's over. That's a wrap.
We had so much fun trying to figure out what Halloween music is. And by fun, I mean it was very challenging. So thank you all for indulging us in a little bit of ridiculousness to close. So people who are on Zoom, this is your moment of decision. If you want to stay for about 15 minutes of small group conversation, please stay. If you are done and ready to move on with your Halloween Sunday, I invite you to log off. It is a joy to be with you in whatever way you are here. Be well.